directories, they're in your boxes, so if you haven't looked in your box before you leave, be sure to pick one up. So at this time though, I'll have Roger come forward because I think Pastor has a message he wants.
I got this morning. Hi Roger, it is 11:58 PM and the nurses have just got done prodding and poking, measuring along with injecting something into me. Now that I'm fully awake, I thought I would send this little note. Please read this to the family and then send it out on the Trinity Messenger. First, I want to thank you for being my elder and caring for me and Victoria and making sure that service could be held. Thank you, Pastor Rick, for taking over. What a way to get a Sunday off. It seems that the issue was high blood pressure. It goes up and goes down, and they want to find out what is going on. That is why they kept me overnight in the hospital. I have already had an echo test on my heart, still beating. Tomorrow will be an MRI on my neck because of the accident, and then a stress test. I always love MRIs. The plan is to be discharged later on Sunday. I feel good, and I hope to be home soon. This is all in the hands of the Lord, of course, and what He wants for me. I'm so grateful Victoria decided to come to see and how her old hubby was doing and that she was able to take me to the hospital on Saturday morning. She is such a blessing to me. Just make sure to keep things going. Diane, make sure the call committee keeps on task. Christine, make sure that the organization committee continues to do their work. And Todd, our president, thank you for your continued leadership. And for our Trinity Church family, thank you for all your prayers. I feel each one of every one of them in my heart, and I hope to be among you soon as the Lord will. In Him who loves us, Pastor Augie. P.S. Thank you for making Victoria feel so much at home. We both feel particularly blessed.
Thank you, Roger. That sounds a little bit louder now with my voice. I'm just playing around with the mic, so that's good. As you see in the bulletin, then you have one other thing to do, the sharing of the peace. So let's rise and do that. And the peace of the Lord be with you.
Oh,
Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, you promised that where two or three are gathered in your name, you are with us. Hear us as we pray.
O Lord, my Jesus, I, a repentant sinner, confess that I have sinned against you. I am deeply sorry. In your mercy and love, please forgive me and renew me to live a godly life.
Our Lord Jesus has heard our prayer. By his command and as his ordained servant, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find rest, each of you, in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, No, we will return with you to your people. But Naomi said, Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, even if I should have a husband this night and should bear sons, would you therefore wait till they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters. For it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. Then they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. And she said, See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law. But Ruth said, Do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go. And where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord do so to me and the Lord also, if anything but death parts me from you. And when Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson today is taken from the book of Romans, the 12th chapter, verses 9 to 21. And here Paul describes for us the qualities of God's agape, which lives in our hearts. Let agape love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal, be fervent in spirit, serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be conceited. Repay no evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourself, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, Vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will put burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Because I need to know who I am.
written in the 16th chapter of St. Matthew, beginning in verse 21. Please rise.
Glory to you, O Lord.
From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his life? Or what shall a man give in return for his life? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We continue by making confession of our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten from his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to his scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I am grace, God's mercy, and God's peace be yours in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. Amen. As you know, there's going to be a different text here, so all of you faithful people who read the book of Ruth at Pastor's direction, I'm going to ask that you maybe just read it again, not because it hurts us to read something twice, but I thought I'd let him, he has a good style of presenting those different stories from the Old Testament, so he'll continue with Ruth, we pray at least by next week, we'll see how things are. So I'd like to just work this morning off a portion of the epistle lesson of the day, written in the 12th chapter of Romans, beginning with verse 19. So 19, 20, and 21. These are the words again which were read to you. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So far the text. If I had to put a title for what I'm sharing with you these next moments, it would be, the key word would be overcome. And I guess the other one is evil. Because how can we overcome evil in terms of our day-to-day life? But perhaps I'm just speaking to an audience that doesn't do anything evil. I think we just confessed something in the church service, and not just this Sunday, but it seems like every Sunday, we say something about, Lord, have mercy on us for the sins I've committed, for the stuff I've done that's really wrong, have mercy on me. And thanks be to God that he does. He doesn't just say, well, I'm going to forgive you about 7 to 10 times, but after that, you're a lost cause. I think as we go through our life, we know that there are constant times when we're in a battle, and especially because we follow this one name, Christ, and we want to do what would please him, then we know that the devil also wants to get after us and sidetrack us and get us to do those things that are sinful and evil in his sight. Let me start with a confession, a good example in my life. For some reason, it's pretty easy for you to know that pastors are not perfect. So I'm just speaking on behalf of Augie and Tom and all the other pastors who have been here through the years. We do commit sins often. I was living in the state of Texas, my first call, back in the 70s. And I was renting a one-room apartment for $110 a month. And it seemed to be going fine. I would be very faithful about paying it and that kind of thing. Well, when I married Linda, that was after about 4 years of living on my own, and she got things a little more organized. But when we were in that one room apartment, and then a little time later, months or a year, quarter or so, something told us, hey, you're going to have a family. So we thought, maybe we better have 2 bedrooms. So we made arrangements within the complex of the apartments there to move to a 2-bedroom apartment. So we did that, people from the church helped move us there, and things are going fine for 1 week. But then the manager of the complex said, Rick, I want you to come here. I've got some news for you. I want you to leave in 10 days. I, of course, was caught off guard on that. I didn't use any bad words, but I was pretty upset about this. And I said, why? I said, well, the owner noticed that in getting the old apartment that you were in, getting it ready, and for the next tenant, that there were a bunch of ants inside the oven and inside the kitchen area, and he wants you to leave because you're leaving such a mess. So here I had to apply some Christianity in some form. I left, my tears were probably coming from inside me. I cried, I think, to Linda. And I felt embarrassed in the sense that I had to ask the people who had just moved me from one apartment to the other to move us again within, it was another, within those 10 days. And then we moved to another complex, another part of town. I didn't have really the best of feelings for that man. Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says Rick. And I wanted to somehow get even with this guy, and yet I knew, hey, in Christianity, you're not supposed to do that kind of thing. Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. I just read that today. Well, we moved there, and I don't remember if it was when we moved on to Albuquerque after that, some years later, or if it happened when we were still in Nacogdoches, Texas. But we found out that the owner who had kicked me out moved into the complex, the original complex that I had been in. And he lived there for about a year, year and a half, then he died. Yeah, just like my face said. How am I supposed to feel now? Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says who? Well, the Lord took care of that one. So I'm still remembering that, though. It's still part of my life because I was upset enough over that one little item. And I wanted to get even. I guess I waited long enough, but I wasn't too pleased with my thoughts even when I heard this guy was toast or dead in the English background. You know. But to remember that I'm not supposed to be taking things into my own hands, but to trust that God is going to have things go fairly, even though it might not be according to my schedule, according to my time. But I needed to place things in His hands and apply what this very word is. But as I'm indicating, there still is a struggle. I still remember, I don't take just great joy that the guy died. At least I don't hear this so many years later. But it simply is saying that the ability to let God take care of it and not to take the vengeance, which the text says, don't avenge things. Don't try to get even with people. But let the Lord administer His justice for them. So much for one reason that I'm a sinner and I need to come here on Sundays too. I don't know, again, if any of you have similar ones or you have other things that you're dealing with right today, that you're still struggling with some things that were years ago, you've asked God to forgive you and He has, but it still comes digging back and God wants to get us to get even, to turn things into our own hands. So that's why we need the text again and we need to be honest with ourselves to say, how well am I dealing with that very issue? Am I overcoming the evil thoughts I have with goodness? Or am I letting the evil overcome me and cause me to want to seek revenge, seek to get even with other people? Look at the text today when Paul is writing to the folks in Rome. And he says what I just shared with you. Don't avenge things. Let God take care of it. Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, it says, what are we supposed to do? Your enemy, it doesn't have to be somebody that you have to kill in warfare, but just somebody that you're really struggling with. And this could happen within your family. Sometimes you marry into a family, you don't always get along with the in-laws. Everything doesn't go perfectly there. And sometimes the tensions arise and you make all kinds of faces and you try not to blurt out words that you later regret. But sometimes that happens too. But it says here in the text, if you see somebody you're having trouble with, they use the word enemy, what are you supposed to do? If he is thirsty, give him water to drink. Give him a drink. that's healthy, don't try to hurt him. If he's hungry, you give him food. Because he says, if you do that kind of thing, if that's what you do in carrying out what I, the Lord, want to command you, and this you can look back in Proverbs 25, that's what Paul's referring to, then if you do that, it will be like putting coals of fire upon his head. I first thought about that, I said, maybe I need to explain that, because does that mean, hey, if we're having a steak someday and somebody you have that you're still having trouble with, you get along with the other three people, but there's one there in that group, it's at your house. You've got these steaks made and you've got those coals underneath it, and you're going to go and take some of those coals and dump it on his head. I think that's going to cause some other problems. The main point is that's really a figure of speech in which it says, when you do that, when you talk to this person, you show this goodness, and you show them the food and the drink and the welcoming, even though you have some of those tensions that are still existing, the very fact that you are still being kind to them and you're showering them with the love of God and the care of God, when you do those kinds of things, then you are doing what is pleasing in God's sight. And the coals of fire are just to a figure of speech for saying it makes the person feel so bad. Like, I've done some pretty rotten things to that person, but now he's doing goodness toward me. And maybe I need to rethink about what I'm doing, that I shouldn't be so vengeful. I shouldn't be that way. And maybe we can even have the courage to say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for what I've done, even though some people have a horrible time just trying to say, I'm sorry. And that's where, of course, the whole theme of what the Christian faith is about is that of when there are people who have disagreed with one another and there have been tensions that have risen between them, if it's been in your own family or if it's been in any community or it's been with people you work with or people that you know that are in your neighborhood and you still have some tensions there, the answer to all of that is still to say, risk it in the direction of showing goodness toward people, showing the love of God toward people, rather than trying to be vengeful about it. Overcome those kinds of thoughts with the goodness that comes from those who know who this gracious God is. And think a minute about what kind of burden Christ is bearing for each of us. If you listen to the gospel today, what did Jesus say? I must go to Jerusalem, and there I must suffer, I must die, but I will rise again. Now Peter, remember, got in there, and it's a whole other sermon, which I won't put in this one, because it'll be too long. But then we need to say, the Lord said to Peter, get out of my sight, Peter. Don't, Satan's got a hold of you right now. You want to get in control of this, let me stay in control. But think about when Jesus went through his ministry, and yes, he wanted to correct his fellow Israelites, get them back on the right track so they would do things that would be pleasing to the Lord. But instead, they ended up crucifying him, accusing him of blasphemy, finding all kinds of ways to find Jesus guilty. And where did Jesus end up because of that guilt? But on a cross. And yet on that cross, what did Jesus do? Was he vengeful to them to say, I'm going to get even with all of you who are unjustly persecuting me? No, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And it would be like if you put your sins, I know if I just put my load of sins upon the shoulders of this Lamb of God, John the Baptist said, behold a Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. If he just took my sins, what a burden that would be. But to think that here in Jesus Christ, the sins of the whole world are upon his shoulders, imagine what that would feel like, what kind of burden that would be. And yet in the midst of all of that suffering and all of that anguish, there he's willing to die for us, that God, the Son, equal with the Father and the Spirit, is willing to join humanity for those 33 years, to be one in ministry to people for those 3 years, and willing to take on the consequences of that sin that is there. And that's why we say, thanks be to God that he has forgiven us our sins. And inasmuch as God has forgiven us, then we are called to forgive one another. Forgive all who have sinned against us, all the ones that we may be struggling with, the ones where it's tempting by the evil one to get us to be vengeful, to get us to catch up with the faults of other people. And yet, not only did Christ die, but he kept the other part of what the gospel said today. He also rose from the dead. And rising from the dead, he has been able to not only conquer sin, but to conquer death itself. He is able to go through those walls on that very same day of the resurrection and say to those people who were hiding inside that building, peace be unto you. He doesn't come in bawling them out and telling them, hey, how come you didn't believe what I said was going to happen? Instead, he comes and says, peace be unto you. And inasmuch as he offers that peace, and he wants them to do it certainly to each other and to the other people that they might deal with in the upcoming days and years of their life, just as it must be when he, by his grace, with the work of the Spirit, comes into this very house this very morning, and we receive from him his very body and blood to forgive us, to tell us that we are his forgiven people, that we are indeed loved by him. And in so doing, of course, listening to the word, receiving his body and blood in the bread and wine, we are thereby battling against the evil one and overcoming evil with the power and the goodness that's in this mighty Lord and Savior who died for us and rose again. It was a couple days ago, I was watching the news, and there was one thing that I don't remember was here in Arizona, if it was somewhere else in the country, but like it happens among sinful people, because we don't do everything right, there was a man who was freed from prison. He had been in for over 20 years, and he wasn't guilty of any of it. There had been a trial that was not administered properly, and the justice was not done. They found the person who had done the crime that he was accused of. But the news people then said to this man who was now out of jail, he said, are you wanting to get even with those people? Are you going to make sure that anybody related to that person, that they suffer? And he said, I'm not going to do that. I have no bitterness, because to keep that bitterness going, to keep the vengeance and to keep getting even with people, that gets us nowhere. It takes energy to dislike people. It takes energy to work hard and say, man, I'm not going to like that person that I have to work with. I don't like that boss. I don't like that employee. If we spend our time and energy doing that, first of all, we've forgotten what God has done for us. He's forgiven us, and if God says, I have forgiven you, then he wants us to do that same forgiving of other people. So it's the calling of us. As you look at your life, and that's sort of your homework for this week, besides reading Ruth again for next week, you know. But the other thing is that you would put down on your little sheet some places where you're still struggling. It's probably you're going to keep struggling, because the devil loves to work on us. And not to abound in forgiveness and grace, but still the vengeance and getting even. But instead, put those things down. Turn them over to the Lord. Let him be the one that will administer the justice for the people that you struggle with. And do that same thing even to yourself, in case you struggle with that self that sometimes is part of our life too. And write those down, hand them over to the Lord, and let him carry that out with his same mercy and grace. So, I guess as you drink, as you eat, as you read God's word, as you go about your life, Place these things in the hands of this merciful Lord. Do it in the spirit of what the text in the epistle lesson is about, doing all those good things that are mentioned in Romans 12. But do it in a way in which you are abounding in the mercy and the love and the peace and the grace that God only gives. And in so doing, life is going to be richer. It's going to be more in accordance with God's will. And we will have a life that will be a blessing to more and more people. Overcome evil by doing that which is good. And do so with the power of the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Amen. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's rise for a word of prayer. Thanks, Lord, for being with us in the midst of the silence, for being with us in the midst of the noise that goes on in our life, in the midst of the days that are hard, in the midst of the days that are not so hard, but are real blessings and a real joy. Thanks for your constant presence with each and every one of us. We don't deserve that. That is simply your gift. Thank you for dying for us, Lord. Thank you for rising again and keeping your word, which you said you would. And help us in thankfulness for your faithfully carrying out your word, faithfully sending the Spirit to continue to work in us now as we travel from day to day. Thank you for the chance then to reflect the love of God, the mercy of God, one to another. For the strength to fight against the evil one when he wants us to be vengeful, when he wants us to dwell in sins of all sorts. Lord, we come before you, trusting in that forgiving love in Christ Jesus our Lord. May we sense that forgiveness in us, and may it guide our lives and what we say and what we do. Thanks for your very body and blood and the bread and wine today. May it increase our faith. May it tell us we are forgiven. May it give us reason to go about the good news that we have to share with the people around us, people that we get along with very well, or the ones we struggle with, or certainly even with the people we don't know. Because you've loved us, help us to love them, both the unknown and the ones we know so well. Gracious God, take care of each of us. We especially bring before you Pastor Augie, his dear wife Victoria. Be with them during these trying times. He knows of a very gracious God, as does she. And we ask that you would surround them with your peace and your presence, that you would give wisdom to doctors and nurses and to those who are taking care of them, knowing that you are that faithful Lord who's been with them all of these years and will definitely stay with them as the good shepherd looking after two of his important sheep. We place him in your hands, and we know that you will heal according to your grace. Be with our other members too who are struggling, who are battling with illnesses, illnesses of mind, illnesses of body, other areas in which the struggle continues. Gracious God, we place ourselves in your hands, the hands of the Lord who will look after us always. Be with our country during these days, during this difficult time with the virus. Give us patience. Give us an example of your mercy and love by showing that to one another, working hard to care for one another, and giving us the patience to endure however much longer it might be. May we remember that you will be there to uphold, you will be there to shield. shield, you will be there to care for each and every one of us, not only in this community, not only in our own personal life, but of our country and the other countries of the world who are also suffering with this. Be with our military personnel in this country and elsewhere in the world. May they be safe. May their families, if they're here and they're thousands of miles away, please may they stay close through prayer, through messages that they send to one another, and may your mercy and love never end. So gracious God, uphold us by your might and power. Keep listening to all the prayers, some which we can verbalize and others that maybe we can't, but we know you'll understand. We place ourselves in the hands of a very faithful Lord, the one who made us, the one who preserves us, the one who died for us, the one who rose again, and the one who sent his Spirit to dwell among us. To that God, Father, Son, and Spirit, be praise and honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we gather our offerings.
Good morning, everyone. Well, that's loud. There's a slight change in the bulletin this morning. Megan's flute has decided to play in minor today. So she is going to play for you another time, and Joni is going to be playing the offertory music today.
Thank you.
given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Thankful for that blessing, we also join now in the prayer which Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Were you there when they laid him in the tomb? Thank you.
rise for the prayer of thanksgiving on page 16. Gracious Holy Spirit, you do not leave us comfortless, but strengthen and care for us through your word and sacrament. You give us family, friends, and neighbors to help us when there is loneliness now and in the days to come. Brighten our future with a firm trust in your promises and care. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Thank you.